Good morning, and welcome to Shawnee Mission Unitarian Universalist Church. Whoever you are, whomever you love, wherever you are on your life's journey, you are welcome here.
Whoever you are, whoever you love, and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Unitarian Universalist congregations affirm and promote seven principles, which we hold as strong values and moral guides. The first, the inherent worth and dignity of every person. The second, justice, equity, and compassion in human relations. The third, acceptance of one another and encouragement to spiritual growth in our congregations. The fourth, a free and responsible search for truth and meaning. The fifth, the right of conscience and the use of the democratic process within our congregations and in society at large. The sixth, the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. And the seventh, respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part.
If you are new to SMUUCh and want to know more about our church, please fill out our Get in Touch form using the link in our video description. Or if you are interested in learning more about Unitarian Universalism, please join us for our Just the Basics class today after the service.
Hi.
Hi from the pantry.
Hi. Oh, arugula? Okay, no arugula.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
Come on.
Hi.
Hi there.
Hello, everybody. It's a great day in the shade.
Can you see the smile in my eyes?
Good morning. I'm Reverend Rose, the minister here at SMUUCh. It is a joy to see you and an honor to be broadcast into your homes. As we settle into this new routine of online worship, we've got a schedule of services that will hopefully keep this fresh, fun, and encouraging to you. Here's how it'll look. Every other week, we'll have a live streamed service. On the off weeks, either I will preach from somewhere exciting in a contemporary service, like today where we have more meditations, or we will hear from a guest preacher or even watch a service from one of the thousands of sister congregations we have around the nation. Because together we are better. Together we are a courageous church, a courageous country, and a courageous world. Let us begin this service by becoming mindful, taking a deep breath in through the nose and out through the mouth. Let the space around you become holy again. Each object or brush of wind from the window, a gift for us to wonder over. Today we will be doing a series of mantras. A mantra is meant to work over time. As you repeat the words to yourself, they can even become mindless. Our first mantra today, we will do in just a second, so close your eyes and say in your mind, I will find the integrity. Just say it over and over. And now come, let us learn and practice this meditative hymn.
Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, ours is no caravan of despair. Come, yet. Come, come, who is no caravan of despair. Come, yet again, come. Come, come, whoever you are. Wander, come, whoever of thee. Ours is no caravan of despair.
Please join me in affirming that love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve humanity in fellowship, to the end that all souls shall grow into harmony with the divine. Thus do we covenant with one another.
Hi, Sheely. Hi, kids.
It's nice to see you guys.
Hey, do you want to hear a joke?
Yeah, I want to hear a joke.
If Hogwarts was in the ocean, they would play Squidditch.
Squidditch? Hey, you guys love Hogwarts.
Hey, want to hear another one?
Yeah.
What music do fish listen to?
What?
Frank Ocean.
Well, Sharky, I invited you here today. I mean, I love your jokes, but I wanted to ask you something.
Yeah, what is it, Seely?
Well, last week we talked about volunteering.
Oh, no.
Yeah, and I just wanted to check in with you about it, because I'm, like, really excited about it, you know? Because, remember, like, service is our prayer, and I'm a devout seal, and I just... Why don't you want to volunteer?
Well, when I volunteered at the coral reef, there was people trying to fish for me.
Oh, right. Yeah, I remember. That was awful.
They want my fin.
Yeah, I remember.
Apparently it is very valuable.
Yeah.
But more so to me.
Yeah, it's most valuable to you.
Most.
Yeah. Yeah, it belongs on you.
Yes, it does.
Yeah. Yeah. And, well... To be honest, there was the other part, too, you know,
that part.
Where you also ate the humans.
Well, when I get too hungry, I have to eat all of the time, and humans are delicious.
So, the pantry, you know, Miss Patrice said she invited us to go, but you're, like, nervous about being at the pantry?
Yes, I am nervous. I am nervous to be around humans. One, because maybe I will eat them. Two, because maybe they will eat me.
Well, the pantry is being really safe, you know? We wear masks and it's outside and, you know, it serves a really important need.
Well, tell me more about the meat.
Well, maybe Miss Patrice knows. Hey, Miss Patrice?
Hi, Seely. Hi, everybody. Hi, Sharky.
Hello, Miss Patrice.
How are you all?
Hi, Miss Patrice.
Good enough,
what y'all talking about?
Well, we were wondering, you know, we wanted to talk about the pantry, but the only way that we could really talk about it is if you tell us about the meat.
So you're interested in volunteering or you're interested in eating?
Well, to be honest, eating. But
eating.
Maybe volunteering.
Well, it would be great if you volunteered because there are a lot of hungry people that are coming to our pantry for food.
I am hungry.
Totally. I've actually volunteered at our garden, was able to pick green beans and then make those for dinner.
I prefer meat.
I heard there's meat at the pantry, but also there's fresh produce.
There is, and even beautiful flowers to brighten up someone's day.
Oh, I don't know. Still makes me kind of nervous.
You know, Sharky, I thought that you went to therapy and got this all worked out.
I was in therapy. It helped a little bit. Also, my therapist was delicious.
Oh, Sharky.
I can't help it.
Aww. Well, what do you think? Will you come to the pantry with me?
Oh, I don't know. I guess if you come with me, Seely.
You want me to go with you?
Yes.
That's
okay.
Awesome.
No problem.
Everything's easier with a friend.
Oh.
Yes. I will go.
You can have some meat at the end.
Okay. But maybe it will be boring. I will try my best to stay involved.
Thanks, Sharky.
Thanks, Sharky. That's all we ask.
This is the time in our service where we expand the caring love of our congregation, where we draw to heart and mind those in our midst who are suffering and those who feel the sweet relief of their burdens easing. I invite you to close your eyes once more and bring to mind someone who you know is suffering. Imagine their smile. Imagine their hands. And let us do the second part of our mantra. You can just say these words over and over in your mind. I find ways to be of service. I find ways to be of service. Take one more deep breath. We give our love to those untangling themselves from relationships that no longer serve them. We grieve for the loss of energy and time that chronic illness takes upon the body and mind, and our hearts go out to all who are struggling to make ends meet. We extend our gratitude to people who make caring for children their primary spiritual practice, especially this week as school started. And we join in wonder with all people who are bravely facing their final days. And as always, we rejoice over the exquisite beauty in this world, as small or life-changing as each piece of beauty might be.
Thank you.
prayers that remain unspoken in the silent sanctuaries of our hearts, I light this final candle. Our reading today comes from Rosemary and Rachel Harding. Their book entitled Remnants, A Memoir of Spirit, Activism, and Mothering. There is no scarcity. There is no shortage. No lack of love, of compassion, of joy in this world. There is enough. There is more than enough. Only fear and greed make us think otherwise. No one needs starve. There is enough land and enough food. No one need die of thirst. There is enough water. No one need live without mercy. There is no end to grace. And we are all instruments of grace. The more we give it, the more we share it, the more we use it, the more is made. There is no scarcity of love. There is plenty and always more. It is my joy to preach to you today from the food pantry, which is a functioning food pantry here at SMUUCh that we are running out of the south wing of our church. As I stand here, I am surrounded by shelves and shelves of food and toiletries. I have with me here today a little humming chorus of refrigerators, and from where I preach, I can see scales, carts, PPE, rows and rows of pre-packaged grocery bags ready to be put into people's cars. And behind those walls, there is an extensive community garden outside, which added 17 new beds this year. Now, to start with some amazing news about this place. We have been open for 7 consecutive Tuesdays, functioning only on that day from 3 to 6. All of the food is brought outside on carts by volunteers so as to put no one at risk of catching COVID-19, which means that a long row of cars lines up through our parking lot and sometimes even winds out of sight. This last week, September 8th, we served our 1,000th person.
We have distributed 15,000 pounds of food, a third of which is fresh produce. We offer an average of 22 different types of fresh vegetables and fruits, and dozens of choices for refrigerated or pantry stock goods and toiletries. This pantry opened on July 28th, 2020. The timing of this is incredible to me. For even 6 months ago, this room looked completely different. The food pantry did not exist. You see, as so many houses of faith shut the doors to their temples or their sanctuaries, we too were grieving the loss of our Sunday services. But nearly every single day since March, a mere few people in our congregation have been here, safely and distantly gutting this room, ripping up carpets, tearing out built-ins, supplying electric, installing shelves, working the hard earth of the garden. Or they've been at home on the phone with other pantries, securing relationships with food sources, raising money, contacting the news, learning the local statistics, failing and persevering. It was like they had seen a light and they were running towards it. Despite the creeping woe and the subtle shutting down, this church has somehow grown and blossomed during this time. Yes, a quarantine miracle has occurred, and it's that same saving grace in which we lay so many of our hopes. For here in this room has occurred the miracle of human hands coming together to form a caravan of hope. It is the regular, everyday miracle of communion. Food being passed from hand to hand, eyes smiling above masks, as basic physical dignity is secured and community is made. And let me tell you, in those first few weeks, every time a car would round the building into view of our little outdoor docking station, it was like a wave of joy passed over the volunteers. You could hear cries of thankfulness, that sense of relief that we could be of use, that we might be of service. And now, every Tuesday, the cars stretch around, forming a caravan. And these people are SMUUCh people. Their every movement is like the pull of a bow on a violin string, adding to the beautiful chorus that ours is no caravan of despair. There's one story from the pantry that I think about frequently. I arrived late on a Tuesday, checking in just as they were closing down. Two women came towards me excitedly, telling me how many cars had come through, how we had held steady from the numbers from the week before. But there was one woman they gushed about. They told me this story, that one woman had come through the line and they had found out that she was taking care of 11 grandchildren. "Oh, we loaded her up," they said. And I could see in their eyes that deep, unerring peace that comes from being of service. I could see their integrity and their joy in that moment, and I knew that something very special was growing here. And thus, I am overjoyed to preach from this particular spot because I like to stand where others have done sacred work. And even more so, I like to preach on holy ground. Because all of this and all of the people who made it happen are working in a beautiful symphony of integrity, service, and joy. But we Unitarian Universalists have always been the doer types. Indeed, many of the direct services that our nation benefits from were formed by people in our lineage. The Red Cross, kindergarten, the mental health care system, just to name a few. For we are people of great faith
and great resolve. And although we may believe in many different things, what we do all believe is that the greatest miracle that occurs on this earth is the human agency that has the capacity to do great work in this world. That it is through our willingness to serve others that we shepherd in the love that will save us. We can come through this time. We can come out of this hole. But in order to do so, we must take up the work that is common. We must be of service to our fellow humans, even when we too are hungry. And in doing so, we will come to know that there is no scarcity. There is no shortage, no lack of love, of compassion, of joy in this world, that no one need to go hungry. There is enough land. No one need to die of thirst. There is enough water. No one need to die from a life without mercy, for there is enough grace and love to go around. For when we join our hands in the line that passes the communion, when we serve humanity, all souls shall grow into harmony with the divine. And so come, come whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, for ours is no caravan of despair. Come, bring the children, come, yet again, come. The work of the church depends on us. But in the context of global and national strife, what does it mean to participate in the work of the church? What does it mean to serve humanity in fellowship until all souls grow into harmony with the divine? We invite you to give generously to support the ongoing work of the church. The offering will now be given and received in grateful appreciation of our shared values. Now let us take a moment and meditate on the message of the sermon. Breathe in through your nose, out through your mouth once more. Just offering yourself some gentleness and kindness, letting some of that stress and worry drain away. Notice if you can feel your breath on your rib cage, on your collarbones, on your nose. Start breathing deeper, just taking slow, deep breaths. Finding something from the sermon that stuck with you. And then we'll do our last mantra for the day. Repeat in your mind after me. I find the joy. I find the joy. Take one more deep breath. Give yourself a little squeeze, especially if you've been isolated. Squeeze your arms. Give yourself some pats. Put your hands over your heart. Just give yourself some gratitude for being here today. Blessed be, and amen. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we meet again. This week, we will have not our benediction, but our mantra-diction. These mantras are meant to work on you slowly. So even just saying them in the morning and evening every day will have a long-lasting effect on you. So let us bring it all together. Close your eyes and repeat after me in your mind. I find the integrity. I find ways to be of service. I find the joy. Blessed be. Go in peace.